Hi, I'm Richard Belzer. This is Baby. Don't go anywhere because Profiles is coming up.
Welcome to Profiles. I'm Marley Hall. Today's guest is stand-up comedian and actor Richard Belzer, perhaps best known for his work as Detective John Munch on Law & Order Special Victims Unit. As a comedian back in 1975, Belzer was part of the original Saturday Night Live cast and warmed up crowds with his stand-up routine and then appeared in sketches. After a short break, we'll join our host Mickey Burns as he welcomes the versatile Richard Belzer to Profiles. Welcome back to Profiles. Richard Belzer began playing Detective John Munch back in 1993, first on Homicide, Life on the Street, and then later on Law & Order, SVU. In addition, he also played Detective Munch on episodes of six other series. Belzer made Munch a brand and has become the only fictional character played by a single actor to make appearances in 10 different shows on 5 different networks. So let's join our host, Mickey Burns, on location from the Hotel Wales on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, as he welcomes Richard Belzer to Profiles.
That's why I lied about the fence.
Okay, now I get it. You're saving your really good lies for some smarter cop, is that it? I'm just a donut in the on-deck circle. Wait till the real guy gets here. Wait till that big guy comes back. I'm probably just his secretary. I'm just Montel Williams. You want to talk to Larry King?
I'm telling the truth.
I've been a murder police for 10 years. If you're going to lie to me, you lie to me with respect.
Richard Belzer, welcome to our show, Profiles.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here.
It's an honor meeting you, actually. For our viewers, you're a veteran stand-up comic, you're an actor, you're a talk show host, and you're an author. A lot of people don't know that about you.
I hope they do.
Yeah, yes, right. But you're most widely recognized for your role as Detective John Munch, a role which originated which I know on Homicide,
right,
and continues on Law & Order.
SVU.
SVU. But how long have you been doing it?
Well, we started Homicide in 1992.
Right.
And I did that for 6.5 seasons,
mm-hmm,
122 episodes.
Wow.
And now we're in our 12th year of Special Victims Unit. So I've been playing Munch for 18 years.
Incredible. You originally were a stand-up comic. I mean...
Yes.
And I was
I started as an actor.
You did.
I'm one of the few people that went the other way, pardon the expression.
Yeah, yeah.
I was in Groove Tube, the film, which was
right,
a review in New York. Then I started doing stand-up in 1971, 72.
Oh, okay. No one has been more typecast in what they do than you,
mm-hmm,
as Detective Munch.
So that's
much
a compliment,
so,
right?
I think so. Okay. So much so that you wrote a book about it.
Yes, sir. Two books.
I Am Not a Cop.
Right.
How do you feel about being typecast to that extent?
Well, the fact that I could write a book about it shows the degree to which the business and the culture has recognized my character. So it's a dream for me. I'm so flattered and lucky to,
sure,
have a character that has been around so long and is able to, I've crossed over, I've done other shows,
sure,
as Munch. So
right,
it's been,
right, a matter of fact,
beyond a dream.
I think I read somewhere that you have a record that you've,
yes,
played this character on 10 different shows?
10 that were, yeah, maybe 11. Because I did, there's a Sesame Street episode where there's a Munch Muppet.
Right,
and,
right.
Yeah, it was 10 or 11, yeah.
All right, come on. Quack. Come on. Quack. Come on.
Quack.
Come on.
Quack.
Hey, Captain.
Look at this. What?
I found the letter M.
Where?
Right here.
This isn't the letter M. It's a duck.
But not just any duck. I am a mallard.
Mm-hmm, that's right. And mallard starts with the letter M.
Well, that may be Munch, but it still isn't an M. It doesn't look anything like an M.
See, that's what I tried to tell him, but who listens to a talking piece of poultry?
What do you attribute? Because the show is incredible, and it certainly has stood the test of time. But what do you attribute the phenomenal success of the Law & Order franchise to?
Well, I think the particular genius of Dick Wolf, who created the series, is that every show... is self-contained. In other words, if you have never seen the show and you see it for the first time, there's a beginning, a middle, and an end. So they're just incredibly satisfying. We're very lucky. We have a team of really wonderful writers.
You sure do.
And the idea that you could watch our show or the other Law & Order shows,
mm-hmm,
any time of day or night, which people do, mm-hmm. and watch the same episodes over and over again.
And it's also been exceptionally a good thing for actors in New York.
Every actor I know
has it on their resume.
Has been in the show at one point or another. Yeah, it's great. I mean, theater people and film people, and
they've also
when you look at the
order.
Roster of famous people that at one point or another were on the show, either as a good guy or a bad guy, it's really a fun list.
Now, you also are what is known as a conspiracy theorist.
Mm-hmm.
And you continue.
Where'd you hear that?
What
makes you say that?
And you are the author of the book UFOs, JFK, and Elvis.
Conspiracies, you don't have to be crazy to believe.
Are you still passionate about conspiracies?
Well, everything's a conspiracy. What isn't a conspiracy?
Right. Do you think our financial collapse is a conspiracy?
No, it's an open conspiracy that banks since 1910 have kind of appropriated all our money and keep robbing us every once in a while. The Depression and the savings and loan scandal and now this recent scandal. I think American people are thankfully finally catching up to really, in a profound way, reorganizing our perception of what banks do to us.
Because
we don't rob banks, they rob us. It's reverse bank robbery. I think the small local banks are really, I think, the wave of the future, and not big corporate banks that have been floating these terrible mortgages and raping people's credit cards. And it's frankly, un-American.
Now, you're a native of Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Yes.
And is it true that as an adolescent, you were asked to leave every school you ever attended?
I wasn't asked. I was thrown. I was thrown out of a lot of schools, public and private.
Mm.
Religious and non-religious. God expelled me from Hebrew school.
Did not do well in school.
Well, I was too smart for my own good. When I was very young, a guidance counselor told me that, brought me into the office with the principal and my parents, and they said, "You're so smart, you could be whatever you want to be. Why are you so bad?" And even as
that's
a child,
question.
Well, I, to myself, I said, "Well, if I could be whatever I want to be, why do I have to work hard?" So I always just got
took the easy way.
C's,
huh? That was it. Cruised.
Here I am.
All right. Now, right out of school,
sir,
I was interested to learn that you were a newspaper reporter.
Yes. Yeah, my first love, actually.
Worked in several newspapers mm-hmm. around the country.
Right.
And when I read that, I was just wondering, you know, how did your interest in journalism, where did it stem from?
Well, I think particularly in the 40s and 50s and the 60s, journalism was much more romantic than it is now. You know, Hemingway was a journalist, and there was a tremendous amount of great reporting during Watergate and Vietnam and the Civil Rights Movement.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So, you know, it was a heroic profession, and I aspired to be a journalist. I mean, if I wasn't a performer, I would
That's
be,
what you'd be doing.
I'd be a reporter, yeah.
Now, other jobs that you've had in your life,
yes,
which
sir.
I found interesting.
Yes, sir.
Teacher?
Right.
Census taker?
Yes.
Dock
1970
worker?
1970 census.
Dock worker?
Yes.
Jewelry salesman?
Yes.
And
drug
when
dealer?
When
prescription medication, of course.
When I read, I was just wondering, did these life experiences of all these different jobs offer comedic material for you when you became a stand-up comic?
Well, if you're funny, whatever experience you have is material. So I was lucky to be kind of a guy who couldn't hold a job. So I had a lot of different jobs, a lot of different experiences, and they're folded into my work. But I think you have to be funny to begin with. You could have a million jobs. If you're boring, you're boring, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When did you realize that you were funny?
In the womb. No. When did I realize I was funny?
Yeah.
Well, I don't have a memory of being not funny.
Mm-hmm.
When I was a very little kid, I remember entertaining my relatives and doing impressions and getting thrown out of every school. And so it was always there, luckily.
Now, you cut, I would say, your comedic teeth in radio.
Yes.
A lot of people can't say that.
Well, I started in stand-up, but I did radio in 78, 79. I was on NBC. Brink and Belzer in the morning on NBC.
Very good. But you also worked in the 70s in the National Lampoon Radio Hour.
Yes.
Which co-starred, a lot of viewers would be interested to learn, John Belushi,
right.
Chevy Chase, who you once said you knew him when he used to be funny.
I knew Chevy when he was funny, yes.
Bill Murray.
Murray, of course.
Gilda Radner.
Gilda, yes.
Harold Ramis.
Harold.
And the program aired 600 radio stations for 3 years.
Yeah, we had so much fun in those
days.
That was before Saturday Night Live.
Yes, it was. What a group.
Yeah, Michael O'Donohue was also involved in that, who was one of the original writers on Saturday Night Live.
Did you just do skits, basically?
Well, we wrote a lot of stuff, but we did a lot of improvising, too. So sometimes we'd have a script, and then we would have basic idea of it, and then we'd go in and improvise.
Right.